I'll stand and sing, if you would, please. And we are going to do number 170. One day, 170.
Worship
leader is here, and we really appreciate everything he's added so far, so thank you. We need a little, like, every once in a while. Brother Doug, could you lead us in prayer, please?
Yes, sir. Oh, what a glorious day it will be, Father, when we come before you. Jesus, thank you for your love and your mercy and your grace that allows us freely to come before your throne.
Amen.
And say thank you. Thank you for the family who showed up this morning. Lord, may you touch our hearts through the Holy Spirit. May we be attentive to what the pastor has to say, Lord. So we walk out of these doors, the world still needs to hear Jesus Christ is Lord. Thank you for your love and your grace to us. In your precious name, amen.
Thank you, and you may be seated. Our next song is 89, Our Great Savior. Sing along with us, okay? People don't know it, so
We're just going to skip that one. I was wanting to maybe teach you that one, but we'll just go ahead and skip that, and we'll do the announcements first, and then we'll have the offering. I want to welcome everybody here this morning. So glad you could be here. It's a new day, a new era of presidency, and it may be worse for us, and maybe it'll be better for us. Maybe we'll suffer more persecution. That's possible, but maybe we'll have better opportunity to share Jesus. Maybe it will open people's hearts. Maybe different things will happen that will allow us to have a better chance to share Jesus. There's just so many things that can happen when these kinds of things happen. I know the Obama years, there's some things I look at and say, wow, that was bad, but this was good. So, and the same thing with the Trump years. And I know many of us voted a certain way. I really had a secret ballot. I'm not telling anybody who I voted. So if you ask me, I won't tell you. You might be able to guess. I always tell my students, you have no clue what my, I'm never going to tell you if I'm a Republican or Democrat. Now, I'll say, you'll probably be able to figure it out. It may slip out, you know, but, and they say, Mr. Evans, who'd you vote for? Haven't told him yet. So I'm going to keep that to a secret. And Sarah's the only one I told it to. So, anyway.
Well,
so I mean,
Sarah, who do you vote for?
She's not allowed to say. But you might be able to figure it out. But I'm not going to go anywhere else with that. We've already talked about the election. We're not going to talk about it at least for 2 years. And then we'll start thinking about it again. And in 2 years, there'll be another election. The House might change. And, you know, maybe that'll be better. Maybe that'll be good. Maybe not. But let's pray. Let's pray for our president. My dad had a picture of George Bush up, pray for the president. And then someone said, well, what about the new president? You haven't changed that yet. So he got the net picture up there the next week, pray for our President Obama. And so we prayed for our President Trump, and now we need to pray for President Biden. If that is true, what actually happens? I mean, you never know. This is weird, but it looks like that's what will happen. So let's pray for our president and the vice president-elect, and the Senate Majority Leader, and the House, Speaker of the House, all those people that are in those positions. It's possible we'll have a different Speaker of the House. So anyway, might pray about that. So I'm glad you guys could be here today in this week of change. It's a week of change, and we can turn over a new leaf, maybe in our witness, maybe in our in interaction with people. It's interesting, you know, the coronavirus numbers are up. They're up a little bit, not hugely, in Bullhead City. It wasn't high enough to shut down the sports in Mojave County, but they shut down sports and tryouts for basketball and wrestling and soccer on Monday in Phoenix. But apparently Mojave County wasn't as high for that, although it might be this week. So they're having tryouts on Monday. That may be for a week. I don't know. So anyway, so let's be vigilant. Let's do our part to keep our community safe. That's always my challenge for every single person. And when I hear people that are like streamed this way, I say, hey man, show respect for those people because they have a motivation for doing it. May or may not be the right one. It may be okay though. And so we shouldn't judge people about that. Just have respect for people that have different views on these things. That's the way I do it. I want to show Christian love and Christian community and caring, and I think we can do that. So as we look at these numbers, let's pray that they level off, go back down, and we can do the things that we love to do. So and then the vaccine, of course, we need to pray for. So anyway, I'm glad you're here today. Rusty isn't here. I think baseball or something's going on. But he told me he wants to have like the greatest light show ever at Trinity Baptist Church. And I guess there's a business competition. He wants Trinity Baptist to win it. So anyway, he's going to work on our electrical in the next couple weeks, and then he has got a light show like you can't believe. He's been collecting stuff over the years. And so we've decided to just do a community event, a drive-up event. We're going to try and social distance and all that, but we are going to do it. We haven't decided which weekend. I think it's maybe 2 weekends or the weekend before Christmas, and we're gonna buy a new nativity scene, a really nice one we'll put out there. It'll be lighted. And we'll have some other things going on. We might have hot chocolate and cookies. And for a weekend, we were talking about having a live nativity, but we need volunteers to be Mary and Joseph. So maybe we can have a little one. You know, maybe Adam and his sister, right? She can do it, I think, maybe. We could have, maybe one night we'll have a little baby nativity scene, and the next one maybe we could get some of the teenagers. Maybe one of these boys who have girlfriends can bring their girlfriend along, and they could be Mary and Joseph.
Yeah.
Well, that would be fun. So, but fun, but also that, you know, churches are still, you know, like one of the largest churches in our town still has not met in the normal way. And but we have. So that's an opportunity for some people to say, hey, man, I want to be in church. So maybe this Christmas we can expand our ministry and our outreach. We got plenty of room. We have plenty of room to distance as well. So let's pray that we can have a ministry. And then, and the gospel is so important. Jesus is what it's all about. I saw something this week that said something about all religions, and I was thinking, that is so opposite of what the Bible teaches. The way to Jesus, the way to heaven, the way, the truth is Jesus only. I think I've told you I'm studying John Locke. That was my last class. I finished it, wrote my paper. And I wrote the paper about his religious views. He came up with this idea. He was a bit irritated with theologians. He wrote a book called The Reasonableness of the Gospel. And in it he said, there's only one real doctrine. It was just a semantics thing. There's only one, and that Jesus is the Messiah. And so in his book, people criticized him, said, what about the Trinity? What about all these other things? In his book, he said, those things are all important, but it's all wrapped up that Jesus is the Messiah, because the Messiah had to be God. The Messiah had to be Trinity and deity and all the important other things that if you had to enter the Anglican Church, you had to confess those or they wouldn't let you into the church. There was no salvation experience. And I think that's what he was trying to get at. It's relationship. You accept Jesus as the Messiah, as the only true way to heaven.
Yes.
And it's interesting because I didn't do enough study to know for sure if that's really what his views were. But that's what I took. I took that idea. That's what he was trying to do. And I think that's a good one. So that's what we want to try and strive for this season. So. All right, I'm talking way too much, and let's take the offering.
Let's see, Kevin, can you hear that?
That's God's blessing on our offering. Heavenly Father, thankful for the opportunity to give. It makes you cheerfully.
Thank you.
that is His Mercy Is More. Sing without the words. It'll take a little bit of time.
I do it though.
Yeah, we can. It's coming.
Yeah, it's coming.
Yeah, it's coming.
What love could we?
Thank you. This is my brother-in-law, David Martin, and his wife, Sonia, helping us out with our worship. Sonia was here for a few weeks the last time. It was nice having her. And now David is here. He trained to be a trained worship leader. You know, like, you know, that's what he did. He learned how to write music, background and stuff. So you could kind of tell that was happening there, and I appreciate it. I wish I had more of that kind of training in some ways, but anyway, appreciate them helping us out as we worship the Lord. For those of you back home, it looks like my camera is off. Let me fix that. Can you get it, Kevin? Yeah, it got loose, I think, so. Got it? Can you see me over here too? Okay. So if you remember, the series that we've been doing lately has been about the citizenship. And I did several messages about citizenship. We looked at some different Bible characters and their example as great citizens, like Daniel. And last week we looked a little bit about with the Apostle Paul. And we also... we look at Hosea. I think we actually looked a little bit at Hosea in one of our messages. And the whole goal was to prepare ourselves for an election, for a great political community event. and make sure that as believers that we act and walk like believers. And so that was our series. This week, I'm going to begin a message. Messages from the book of John. Messages from the book of John. So I'm going to just kind of walk through the book of John. I don't know exactly if I'll cover every single message, but the goal is to point towards Christmas time and the incarnation. But if you're going through the book of John, you got to deal with John chapter 1. So in a way, John chapter 1 is the most Christmas, the most birth of Jesus message you could ever give. And you probably thought, hey, he's jumping the gun. It's like, is he really going to play Christmas carols before Thanksgiving? You know, you know that kind of feeling? Don't feel that way. John 1 really is more about who Jesus is. Overall, his whole character in John chapter 1. It's a great passage of scripture. It is one you can answer so many questions of skeptics, of people that don't understand, people that don't understand how Jesus is so unique. Our God is a unique God. You know, there's different religions out there. Like, take the Hindus and the Buddhists. There's so many gods. It's unbelievable. It's you could just hundreds, thousands of images of a God that are put together in those religions. With Jesus, it's so unique. It's Jesus only. In a way, it's very simple, like John Locke said. There's only one true doctrine. It's Jesus is the Messiah. He is God. And that in that word Messiah, it wraps up a lot of things. He might have been a little bit, that might have been going too far, but I'm just saying it's God. It's Jesus. He's one God. And we find that here in John chapter 1. And these verses really show us a lot. They give us much. So let's go there to the scripture. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made, really. These three verses encapsulate so much about who our God is. Ladies and gentlemen, I can't emphasize enough. The things that I'm going to tell you about right now are so important. We have a society, and you've heard me talk about it, I probably talk about it too much, the progressive concept that changes, things are changing, truth changes, values change, God can change. God can take this form or that form or that form or this kind of God or this different type of religion or different way of worship. This puts all of that stuff away, these three verses. That Jesus is the only God. He is the only one to be worshipped as God.
Yes.
It's all here in these three verses. We're going to go into others that give even more insight, but it's just incredible. So we're going to start off, if you'll notice the message from the back of your bulletin, it is Jesus becomes God. This is what John 1 tells us about. It's the best, most direct, amazing, what?
He said Jesus becomes God.
Jesus, well, yeah. Jesus, that's not really the right word that I meant to say. I mean, Jesus is God. It should say Jesus becomes man. That's what I should have said, yeah. So how did I do that? Yeah, anyway. Anyway, so yeah, it should be Jesus becomes man. That's the title of this message. And yeah, thank you for pointing that out. So let's because we're going to read about how he came to this earth. So let's take a look at verse 1. It says, Jesus is the Word. And let's take a little bit of time on the Word. Okay? The word is a Greek word. The word is a Greek word. Logos is the Greek word that denotes Jesus, and it's used many times for Jesus. The same word is used for Jesus in the Aramaic Bible in Isaiah 45:12 and 48:13. Let's take a look at those. I have made the earth and created man upon it. In the American, it is I, by my word, have made. And it uses that word, Logos. It uses that same word in the Aramaic language. So it's a very important word, that word logos. There's so much in it as we take a look at this. The Jews use this word to denote the Messiah in the Targum, a Jewish commentary on Deuteronomy 26, 17, 18. The word in Hebrew is used to denote the Messiah. Let's take a look at those verses. The word logos is used by the Jews who were scattered by the Gentiles. Greeks that were students of Plato also used the word logos for the Messiah. So this it encapsulates so much. In Jesus is that word. In the beginning was the word. This is Jesus and this is God. And by using that word, there's so much in it. The way the word is used in so many different languages, the way it's used in so many different ways, it encapsulates so much. So it's a very important thing to consider as we look at who Jesus is. Jesus, and this, in the beginning was the word, in Jesus was God, deity and unity. Not a God, it is God.
Yes.
Not a God, it is God. Let me grab my Bible here. Somewhere here. As we take a look at these important concepts. Let me find it here. So it was in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And we'll get to that in a minute. But Jesus was God, deity and unity, not a God, not a God. That the in the Jehovah's Witness Bible, they add that article A. Instead of Jesus is God, it is a God. So it creates this concept that there could be more than one God in a sense. That's not what's here. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And we'll get to that. The name God is elsewhere given to him, showing that he is the supreme God. The name God is elsewhere given to him. He is the supreme God. Romans 9:5. Who are the fathers? Of whom are concerning flesh? Christ came, who is over all. God bless forever. This is God. Deity and unity. Fully God. And one God. Hebrews 1:8, it says, but unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is a scepter of thy kingdom. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness, the scepter of thy kingdom. Giving that idea that there's one God, this one God, only Jesus. 1 John 5:20, and we know that the Son of God is come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. So it mentions Jesus, but then at the very end, referring to the same Jesus, this is the true God. There's no other God and eternal life. And then we get to that next phrase, Jesus is with God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. That's another interesting concept, because now, if it's with, that creates this different concept. Already establishing, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. But in the beginning was the Word. So we have that concept, Jesus is God, but now you're saying with. How do we justify that? How do we get to that point? Let's take a look. Here they're described as distinct personalities. John 17:5, and now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, and with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. So we're getting this distinct personalities. This is the deity. This is the concept of the Trinity coming forth. That, yes, they are one God, but in those separate persons, those separate personalities. I can't tell you how that happens. It's one of the greatest truths about who God is in the Scripture. And it's found over and over and over, especially here in John 1. But as my human mind looks at this concept, 3 in 1, is that? Yes? Can it really? How does that get there? I don't know exactly how that happens. But I know there's only one God, and I know those three personalities in God. It's true. At creation. Now, this is an interesting thing, because if we say, and thank you for pointing that out, David, if we say that there's this one God, Jesus was always God. He never left that part of him. Yes, he came to this earth as a man. And he did the things that he did. He went to the cross and all of those things. He's still God. Well, if he's still God, what about, was he at creation? And this passage helps us with that. In Genesis 1:26, we read, and God said, let us, it says in the plural, and that's exactly what it's saying. Let us make God in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth on the earth. So is Jesus at creation? Yes. He's at creation. I could get into other places in the Old Testament where Jesus shows up. Those are called Christophanies. They're really interesting. Like in the fiery furnace, there's another person in the fire with the three Hebrew children. That's Jesus. Again, amazing supernatural occurrence when we think about the deity of Christ and his Trinity, the Trinity of Christ. At creation, we see him. His purpose in verses 4 and 5, let's take a look at his purpose as we continue reading. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. To bring new life, Jesus came. This God-man came. He came to give life, to give new life. That was the purpose of Jesus being on this earth. That was his purpose. And it's great. We should never forget this concept that Jesus is the light. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light in the darkness did shine, and the darkness did not perceive it. And the light in the darkness did shine, and the darkness did not perceive it. We see that Jesus, that is his purpose. By bringing the light of Jesus, Isaiah 9, 1 and 2, let's go back to the Old Testament and see what that is. If there's more to that. Nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in her vexation, when at the first he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward did more grievously afflict her by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan and Galilee of the nations. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them the light shine. This is a prophetic passage looking forward that Jesus would come and give light to the Israelites. The light would come, and that would be Jesus. He came to give light, and that light is the righteousness that he would give us in our hearts. And we read about the forerunner here in verses 6 through 9 as we continue through this scripture. There came a man sent from God whose name was John. This one came for testimony, that he might testify above the light, that all might believe through him. That one was not the light, but that he might testify about the light. He was the true light, which doth enlighten every man coming to the world. So here we read about John, the forerunner, the one who would come before him. And it was part of God's plan. And sometimes we read about John the Baptist and what he did. He was such an incredibly sold out, giving up of self to serve Jesus. He was the forerunner. People would come to him and say, are you the Messiah? I said, no, Jesus is coming. One who I can't even put, I couldn't wear his shoes. Like he is so much greater than me. What a great example for us. So much greater than us, Jesus is so much greater than me. And that was John the Baptist, to be the forerunner. And It's one of these prophetic things. John the Baptist predicted in the Old Testament several times that this forerunner would come. And his example is a great example for us. He was the great testimony, the great witness. And when I think about John the Baptist, I'm challenged about my own testimony. Like what if God called me to do the same thing that John the Baptist did? Would I meet that challenge? And I think we all have that challenge in a sense too. John 1:31, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. More information about John the Baptist. And then, because of God's plan, the duty of laying all our honors at the feet of Jesus, again, speaking about John the Baptist, This is what John the Baptist did. As John came that all might believe, so it is no less true of the ministry of Jesus himself. He came for a similar purpose, and we may all therefore trust in him for salvation. We should not rely too much on ministries of the gospel. Ministers of the gospel. They cannot save us any more than John could, and their office, as his was, is simply to direct people to the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. So we need to direct people to Jesus. And then verses 10 through 14, the incarnation. And it shouldn't say, it's Jesus becomes God, it's Jesus becomes man. And there, here we read directly of those words in verse 10. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. Verse 12, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Verse 12. Received to become the sons of God. But as many as were to become the sons of God. Now that doesn't mean we're God. But it does mean we're in God's family. And that's a wonderful thing for the believer. Sons of God. That's how we're looked at. We're one of his. We're in his family. We're adopted into his family. Verse 14 defines the incarnation. Let's go back to that. Verse 14. The Word was made flesh. Jesus was made man, dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. This is our God. In this short passage, we read of who Jesus is. This God that came to this world, to this earth, to become man. And he did it to give light to us, to give light to the world. That's my challenge. That's my message for you today. That as we look forward to this season, as we look forward to this new, like we said today, it's kind of a new era, a new presidency. The effect of Jesus on our life should be so much greater than anything else. It really should. It should be, you know, like I was talking with someone recently, and we were talking about the legalization of marijuana, okay? So, and I'm just going to tell you, when you go to vote, you take principles. Now, for me, I took the principle that if you're gonna smoke marijuana in a recreational way, not in a medical way. I mean, we do all sorts of drugs to help us with pain, you know, don't we? We do. So there's all sorts of things that maybe we shouldn't do recreationally. The Bible, you've heard me talk about this, the Bible does not prohibit in a very direct way the use of alcohol. And that's always been my position, you've heard me say it. I'm a teetotaler on principle. I don't touch, but that's just me. That's just the principle. But I can't tell that to someone and say the Bible says you can't have it, period. That's not there. I could say the principle might lead me there. Okay, let's take marijuana, same thing. If I'm medically in pain and it gives relief to pain, you know, we know about pain in my family because of Caleb. And we've had these conversations a lot. And we've discussed it. Our doctors even recommended it. And we've decided not to, but you know, we've considered it. But the recreational side, the Bible does talk about drunkenness a lot, right? So to me, if you're taking a drug to get high, right? If you take a drug to get high, then in a sense, that's a form of drunkenness. So that's how I couldn't vote for it. That's a biblical principle, nothing else. Now, I don't know, maybe there's a Christian who would fight me on that, or you say, wait a minute, man, there's other things involved, or I've got another idea. I don't see that. I could never, that's a principle from God's word. that if you're taking marijuana to get high and partying with it or whatever, in a sense, it's a very, very direct form of drunkenness, really. So to me, a believer, struggle with that. But what I'm talking about is letting the life of Jesus affect your life. If you go to the polls and you vote, or you make a decision about lifestyle, about entertainment, do you look at Jesus and what he thinks? That's how we should make our decisions. We should look at principles from the Word of God and apply them to our lives. And seriously, we should. And, you know, that's what churches should be doing. We should be talking about these things. How do we apply the Word of God in this particular situation? Now, everybody has to do it for themselves. They've got to take it into their heart and they've got to take it into their life and apply it. But Jesus, remember what Jesus thinks. You know, what would Jesus, you hear that, what would Jesus do? It's way too overused maybe. But we should look at the principles of Scripture. And in this passage, we read about Jesus coming to this earth and the effect that he had, how he saved us. Only God can do that. He was the light, and he saved us through the light. He enlightened us, gave us eternal life through the rest of his work. But it was God become man, and only God can do that. Only God can save. He is the only one God. He's the only one that can save. And he is the one we should look to for guidance. His word, his principles. Those are the things that would help us make decisions, like as I just mentioned about that bill. And it got passed. So some people obviously aren't, they're not looking at what God would think. And maybe we shouldn't judge people. I mean, seriously, don't judge people too harsh when they make decisions like that who don't know God. If you don't know God, then drunkenness is okay, maybe. You know, I know a lot of people who think drunkenness is okay, but I know very few Christians that would say drunkenness is okay. So if you're okay with drunkenness, then you probably could have voted with that with a clear conscience. But drunkenness is definitely a principle in God's word, like over and over and over and over and over. Like I could give you 25 passages about it. So it's not a question. I think Christians would have, even the left-leaning Christians would have even a struggle to say drunkenness is okay. So anyway, that wasn't where I was wanting to go with that. But my challenge to you is to take the effect of Jesus with you this year as we make the change that Jesus is with you, that we are the sons of God. May we be the sons and daughters of God and live like it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for your word. Thankful for how you have worked in our lives. And for many of us, you've illuminated us and helped us to understand about the gospel. We understood what Jesus did. We understood he's the righteousness. And we understood how he came and made a difference for us. And Lord, may we take the principles of the scripture that are so clear and vivid. Help us to apply them. The difficult ones, help us to study them. Help us to do our best to want to please you and live a biblical life. And Lord, may we be the light like John the Baptist was in this world, in this year, in this new election year and election cycle. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.